योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचाम् मलम् शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तम् प्रवरम् मुनीनाम् पतञ्जलिम् प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहुपुरुषाकारम् शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणम् सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतम् प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिम् हरिः ओम्। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः हरिः ओम्। सो लास्ट टाइम इन थ्री सेशंस थ्री पार्ट्स वी कवर्ड सूत्र 2.13 that covered pretty much all of the details of how the karma operates, and essentially a detailed description and coverage of the karma siddhanta. So this time we proceed to the next sutra, which is 2.14. The sutra is Te Lada Paritapa Phalaha Punya Punya Hetutvat. So te refers to what was mentioned in the previous sutra, the Jati Ayur Bhogaha. So if you remember, it was Satimule Tadvipako Jati Ayur Bhogaha. So te Jati Ayur Bhogaha Lada Paritapa Phalaha Punya Punya Hetutvat. So Lada is an interesting word used here by Patanjali. It means sukha, but has this tinge of pleasure, sort of sensory pleasure. Lada can also mean delight. For example, it says, one says, Ladate Chandano Gatram. So by applying sandal paste, the body or the limbs, they feel a certain kind of delight. So that is lada. Paritapa similarly is dukkham, but also has a special tinge of sort of being tormenting. So lada paritapa phalaha. So though these are the jatiyayur bhogaha are fruits, phala, of the nature of delight or torment. By what? Punya punya hetutvat. Depending on whether they have come about or have the cause as punya, that is meritorious deeds, or apunya, the opposite kind of deeds. So te lada paritapa phalaha punya punya hetutvat. This is Sutra 2.14. And Vyasa has a very short elaboration which we'll quickly cover. He says, Te Janmayurbhogaha Punyahetukaha Sukhaphalaha Apunyahetukaha Dukkhaphalaha Iti. So he is just clarifying that it is respectively Sukha and Dukkha depending on whether it is Punya and Apunya. So the Punyahetuka are Sukhaphala, Apunyahetuka are Dukkhaphala. Hetu means cause. The caused by Punya is sukha phala, and so on. Yatha chedam dukkham pratikulatmakam evam vishaya sukha kalepi dukkham astyeva pratikulatmakam yoginaha. Now he makes a significant statement which is a bit confusing but gets completely clarified in the upcoming sutra. So he says, Yatha chedam dukkham pratikulatmakam. So just like dukkha is pratikulatmaka, it is something that nobody wants, nobody likes. So dukkha is opposite of what you want. So that is pratikula. Anukula,
Undesirable.
undesirable. Yes. Anukula is along what you would like, sort of convenient and desirable. So yatha, just like idam dukkham, the dukkha that comes about is pratikulatmakam, that is of the nature of being undesirable. Evam, similarly, Vishaya Sukha Kalepi. even at the time of experiencing pleasures or objects of pleasures, right? Vishaya sukha kalaha means the when experiencing the objects of pleasure or happiness, dukkham astyeva pratipulatmakam yoginaha. So for the yogi, even the pleasurable experiences coming from objects of pleasure are of the nature of dukkha only and pratikulatmakam only, so undesirable only. But to whom? To the yogi. Now why and so on, that we'll see in the next sutra. But here with this line, Vyasa sort of opens the gate to the upcoming sutra 2.50. And this finishes his short two sentences on 2.14.
So actually, although Vyasa has only two statements here or two sentences, there is enormous purport in this sutra, because the sutra says te lada paritapa phalaha punya punya hetuvat. Now you just have heard the lada is a pleasure which is sensed, delight which is sensed, and paritapa is the sorrow which is sensed, because there are so many pleasures and pains. That means although they correspond to pain and pleasure, that means te lada paritapa phala uradim te sukha dukkhatmaka phalaha punya punya hetutvat. But why that the aphorism is not saying or using the word sukha dukkhatmaka? It is because there are so many pleasures which come to us, but we never identify, we don't even notice, we don't even feel. There are so many pleasures or sukha, and there are so many sorrows which are not sensed. Now, being there, a sutra being referred to phala, vipaka, fruition, because when it says te lada paritapa phala, te means what? Te means karma vipaka, jati, ayur, bhoga, form of vipaka, which was seen in last sutra. So, jati, ayur, bhoga, taking birth, lifespan and life experience will be giving some sensible pleasure and sensible pain, and the reference is to that. What the pain which is sensed is paritapa. Otherwise, there are so many pains which are not sensed or which are not construed as or conceived as pain. And there are so many delights which are not sensed or which are not conceived or construed as delights. Then they won't be fruit. That won't be fruit, because the fruit must be experienced. So the sukha which is experienced is lada, and dukkha which is experienced is paritapa. That is why aphorism doesn't use the sukha dukkha words which already have come in the sutras. Although these two expressions refer to sukha dukkha, but then the point is it is phala vipaka. So the fruition must be felt, the fruition must be experienced, the delight and sorrow must be experienced, then it is a fruit. If it is not experienced as delight as delight and pain as pain, then it's not a fruit at all. So that's why the word here, words are lada paritapa phalaha fruition. The fruit must be always experienceable. There is no point in having fruit which is never experienced at all. That's not fruit at all then. So the karma vipaka will be always giving an experience which is sensible, which can be experienced, which can be felt. So that is of the nature of pain or pleasure. That's why our life is nothing but vestige of सुख एंड दुख, पेन एंड प्लेजर विच वी एक्सपीरियंस. दैट इज दैट्स वाई द वर्ड लाद परिताप फलाहा. नाउ द लाद इज ड्यू टू ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ द पुण्य कर्म विच आर गिविंग फ्रूट्स. द मेरिटोरियस डीड्स व्हेन दे फ्रुक्टिफाई बाय वे ऑफ जाति, बाय वे ऑफ आयु, बाय वे ऑफ विपाक भोग, दैट विल बी लादात्मक. इट विल बी गिविंग प्लेजर. द फ्रूट विल बी प्लेजरेबल. द फ्रूट विल बी डिलाइटफुल व्हेन मेरिटोरियस डीड्स आर फ्रुक्टिफाइंग. There is no meritorious deed that can be said as fructified without giving us delight. If there is no delight, then we can't say any virtuous karma has fructified. So we must experience the fruit. The fruit is always to be experienced. The fruit always has a taste. So similarly, the karmas always have a taste, and that's why the word in Karma Siddhanta is कर्म विपाक, कर्म फल, कर्म फल फ्रूशन. द फ्रूशन, द फ्रूट मस्ट हैव टेस्ट. सो द मेरिटोरियस डीड्स विल गिव लाद, डिलाइट. एज श्रीनिथ सेड, इट इज सेंसरी बिकॉज द डिलाइट इज ओनली डिराइव्ड बाय आवर सेंसेस. देर आर फाइव सेंसेस एंड प्लस माइंड, द सिक्स सेंसेस. If they experience delight, then that is fruition of punya karma, meritorious deed. While the papa karmas will invariably give fruit of the nature of paritapa, some sort of agony, some sort of pinch, some sort of undesirable experience, pain, sorrow, tormentation, etc. So, we experience that our life is nothing but unfoldment of pains and pleasures, and this is because of the punya karma and papa karma fructifying. So the karmas are fructifying into our life experience. It could be birth. Sometimes the birth itself is a painful birth, or wherever the birth has taken, some people have this kind of grudge. Oh, I am born in such a family where I have been tormented and where I have to suffer. Or the lifespan is such. People say the lifespan is troublesome. Oh, life I have been suffering. There is hardly any pleasure in my life. I am just suffering and suffering and suffering. The experience is just suffering, sorrow and sorrow. But the fact of the matter is that's not true. Nobody experiences exclusively delights in life or exclusively sorrows in life. There is always alternation. There is always a blend. It is hide and seek of pain and pleasure. This is what the life is. Like the game of hide and seek, our life is nothing but pleasure comes, pleasure goes, pain comes, pain goes. Pleasure comes, gives pleasure. Pleasure goes, gives pain. Pain comes, gives pain. Pain goes, gives pleasure. So the pain and the life is nothing, but it can be classified as a blend of two, or alternation of the two, or combination of the two. That's what the life is. Now, the karmas are fructifying into phalas. The phalas are of the three kinds, threefold, that is jati, ayu, bhoga, according to the last sutra. Therefore, he says te, that means karma vipaka, of the nature of jati, ayu, bhoga, birth, lifespan, and experiences, are of the nature of lada or paritapa, on account of merit or demerit, virtue or vices committed earlier. Now, if we take a little deeper dip into this, that means karmas are giving karma phalas. So, in Adhyatma, there has been wonderful guideline given about karmas. there is classification of the karmas. Patanjali himself has given one classification, that is Shukla Krishna, Shukla Krishna, Ashukla Krishna. Meritorious or sinful or mix of the two, blend and combination of the two, or neither merit nor demerit. Now, the last karma will not have fruit. That is why the yogis perform those karmas which we'll come to know later. Because they don't have fructification. They don't have fruition. They don't have fruit. Because it is Ashukla Krishna. Or it is a Nishkama Karma according to Karma Yoga. So Nishkama Karma also will not result into fruit. Now, spiritual seekers, yogis are seeking that. They do not want the life to be crowd of pains and pleasures coming and going, appearance, disappearance, etc. They want smooth life, unalloyed life. That is by Ashukla Krishna Karma. So Patanjali gives a classification of four karmas, four types of karma: Shukla Krishna, and Ashukla Krishna. Now, in Adhyatma, we are given further details about karmas. Like there are sattvic, rajasic, tamasic karmas, qualitatively. So sattvic karmas will be primarily giving pleasures, delights, happiness. Rajasic karmas, they will be giving sorrows. The theorem in Gita, rajasastu phalam dukkham. Rajoguna is the major cause or cause of sorrows. And then tamoguna is similarly either veiled kind of pleasure or veiled kind of sorrow. But it is sorrow. So, sattvic karmas, rajasic karmas, tamasic karmas. If we want more and more delight in our forthcoming lives, we must commit sattvic karmas. Then there will be greater proportion of lada or delight in next life. If it is primarily rajasic karma, then there will be a lot of sorrow. Then if it is again tamasic, again it will be sorrowful life. So sattvic, rajasic, tamasic karmas, so these are wonderfully described in Dharma Shastra, Gita Shastra. So one needs to understand which are sattvic karmas, which are rajasic karmas, which are tamasic karmas. No point in just saying that merit gives pleasure. What about if you have to have pleasure in prospective lives? You must know what is the cause of such karma, such phala. Just saying that merit gives sukha, we should know merit means what? Qualitatively, sattvic karma. So sattvic, rajasic, tamasic is another classification where we are given some kind of guidelines, some kind of prudence, intelligence to understand, to assess our karmas, whether it is sattvic karma or rajasic karma or tamasic karma. If it is sattvic, it is going to give delight. If it is rajasic, it is going to give pain. If it is mix of the two, it is going to give alternation and mix of two kinds of experiences. Tamasic is also going to give sorrows. So sattvic, rajasic, tamasic is classification of karma which Gita Shastra gives. In Adhyatma, we should be aware of this. And then we'll be becoming more discreet about our karmas. We will try to assess the karmas on the basis of sattva, raja, tamagunas. So that is one class of karma. Another class of karma is sharirika karma, vachik karma, and manasik karma. So karmas also, instrument-wise or instrumentation-wise, the instrument of karma is either body or mind or speech. So again, Bhagavad Gita casts a light on this classification. Kaya, kayik karma, vachik karma, manasik karma. Kaya, vacha, manasa karma. So we must understand, because the instrument, sometimes the instrument is such that by that instrument, you will be not doing virtuous karma, or you might be doing mixed karmas, or you might be doing invariably wise karma. So instrument must be also considered. What instrument is one wielding? Like if I'm wielding AK-47, what is the chance of committing virtue? If I am carrying some explosives, handling explosive, carrying explosive, dealing with explosive, what is the chance of committing virtue? So that those are instruments through which karmas are performed. And then with our, as far as our embodiment is concerned, kaya, vacha, manasa are three instruments of karma. So we should know what is kayik, punya and papa. What is kayik, vachik, punya and papa. What is manasik, punya and papa. Because these are three instruments with which we are going to perform karmas. Kaya, vacha, manasa. So from instrument perspective, we must be clear about what kind of vice or virtue can be performed by body. What kind of vice and virtue can be performed by mind. What kind of vice and virtue can be performed by speech. And then that can be discrete and we can be filtering. If we are conscientious, then we will be more considering to see that we avoid committing sins from the perspective of instrumentation. So this is the important classification. Then there's another classification from Adhyatma point of view, which says Sanchita, Prarabdha and Kriyamana. Kriyamana means the karmas which are actualized by this embodiment in this life. The karmas which are carried out in this life, they will entail a fruition. They are not fruition of karma. They will have a fruition subsequently. Kriyamana karma means by one's own volition, will, one carries out the karma in present life. That is called Kriyamana karma. Then Sanchita karma is that latent deposit of karmas, which is stored in the form of vices and virtues. Prarabdha is the karma that we are experiencing. Because if you recall, I said karma has both the meanings, activity, action, act, as well as fruit, fruition. That is why when we are ill-fated, we say, oh, this was my karma. So this was my karma, that is called prarabdha karma. This is my karma means it is going to give fruit prospectively. So Sanchita, Kriyamana, Prarabdha. About Prarabdha, I had given you details in one of the previous sessions, so I will not be repeating it. Then, according to Gita, there is one more classification, which is karma, akarma, vikarma. Karma means an act. It could be vice and virtue both. Akarma is what we should not be doing. And sometimes by refraining ourselves from doing an act, we can either commit virtue or commit vice. You can't say, I have not done, so I should not, no vice should be credited to my account. Because there are certain non-doing, and non-doing itself is a vice. And therefore, we must be also aware of this karma, akarma, doing and non-doing. If the doing is going to give fruit, non-doing is also going to give fruit. So there will be some difference between the fruit of doing and fruit of non-doing. So karma, akarma. In Adhyatma, akarma has another meaning as well, which is the karma that one should not be doing. So not doing is also a karma, and not to be doing it is also a karma. That's why there was expression in previous generation, akarmanyam, means if somebody has done something that one should not be doing it, a sinful act. That was called that is called akarmanyam. So akarmanya has two meanings. One is something which we should not be doing. It's a taboo actually. We should not do. That is akarma. And we have not done. It's also akarma. Then vikarma. Vikarma is beautifully elucidated by Sri Ramanujacharya in his Gita Bhashya. Vikarma means like sugar-coated pill. Why the pill is sugar-coated in medicine? Because the medicine is bitter and therefore it is sugar-coated. So, vice-coated virtue and virtue-coated vice. An act seems to be virtuous for us, which is only a coat, outer coat of it. And therefore we think this is virtue, and actually it is intrinsically a vice. So, sin, which is virtue-coated, and virtue, which is sin-coated, that is vikarma, according to Ramanujacharya. Different commentators have given different meanings, but Ramanujacharya's meaning is most apt with reference to Bhagavad Gita. Because if you heard last time, karmani api bodhavyam, akarmani api bodhavyam, which Srini said last time, you should know what is karma, what is akarma. And then vikarma also has to be known. So if the vikarma is a vicious act, then akarma cannot mean vicious act. It's only non-doing. But akarma has both the meanings. So karma, akarma, vikarma. This is according to the karma vijnana, the science of karma yoga. Karma, akarma, vikarma. This is another classification. So sattvic, rajasic, tamasic, as beginners we must know these classes. Sattvic, rajasic, tamasic, kaya, vacha, manasa, and prarabdha, sanchita, kriyamana, and karma, akarma, vikarma. Then from Dharma Shastra point of view, which is again very important, there is a classification. Nitya karma, naimittika karma, kamya karma, nishiddha karma. So if we are not well aware of these classes, or this particular class, nitya karma. Now nitya karma is such a karma that it must be performed. By performing, you don't collect merit. But if you don't perform, you collect demerit. So those are called nitya karmas. You don't score any merit by doing it, because that is your bounden duty, and it's a daily duty, a daily kind of karma. But if you don't do, you attract sin. That is nitya karma. The best example is sandhyavandanam. By doing sandhyavandanam by the twice born, he doesn't collect any virtue. But not doing it certainly attracts sin, papa, according to Dharma Shastra. Naimittik karma means incidentally coming, occasionally coming, on certain occasions, because of certain occasions, situations, scenarios, the karma has come. So that is naimittika karma. They are not daily karma. They are not a daily routine karma. But once in a while it comes. Such as Purnima Amavasya. So by nimitta of Purnima Amavasya, we have to perform certain karmas. Ekadashi. We have to perform certain karmas because of Ekadashi. So, and then incidental. So there are so many incidental karmas. They are not part of daily routine. They come in, don't come in your diary. Those are used to you having a diary. That will not come in your diary. There are contingencies. And because of contingencies, some karma has come up. So that is naimittika karma. Kamya karma. Kamya means having, we having desire, passion, yearn for something, and therefore we do it. Kamya karma. For our own well-being. For ishta prapti, anishta nivrutti, it is our kama. It is our desire that we must have ishta prapti. Desirable must be attained. Undesirable must be kept at bay. This is our desire. So ishta prapti anishta nivrutti rupa karma is kamya karma. Then nishiddha karma, taboo. Certain acts, karma should not be done. So we must identify what is nishiddha karma for me. If we don't identify it, then we might commit consciously or unconsciously, aware or unaware, but then we'll collect the fruit of it, certainly. We'll be responsible to experience the fruits of it. Therefore, we must also identify what is taboo. What is it that I should never, ever, ever do it, nowhere, never, ever. In any situation, in any condition, I should not do it. So we must be clear about these karmas. What are these karmas? Which I should never ever do it anywhere, anytime, in any situation. So if you are clear about it, then we will identify such karma is coming, encountering us. We can take easy decision that this is the karma. I will never do it. I should never do it. So Dharma Shastra gives another classification. So these few classifications give us guidelines in karmas. We can assess the karmas and we can classify the karmas and we can be more discerning about the karmas and we can develop prudence and acumen with regards to karma, which is incessantly carried out. Naikaschit chanati jato tishtati akarma krut. Bhagavad Gita. That not even a moment passes without karma. Then we must be discerning, like a car driver is looking through the windscreen and then driving. So this classification gives some discernment to us. We are discerning about the karmas and then we will be able to take proper decisions. Therefore, this is very important that these are the karmas, because we are dealing with karma phalas, which are karma phalas. What are the karmas? So we are given some sort of guidelines by Adhyatma Shastra and Gita Shastra, Yoga Shastra. So this is also implied for both of the sutra. Because punya and papa karmas, they will be higher by these classes, which I just now mentioned. We'll be collecting vice and virtue through these classes, which I just now mentioned. So therefore, they give some sort of discerning condition for us. Like a car and driver has a windscreen, clear windscreen, he will drive, he will take proper decisions to drive the car. So that's why this is given by Adhyatma Shastra. So this is implied in the sutra. Okay.
So now, once again, just repeating the last line of Vyasa. Yes, he had said, "Yata chedam dukkham pratikulatmakam eva." विषय सुख काले भी दुखमस्तव प्रतिकूलात्मक योगिन सो विषय सुख काले इवन इन टाइम्स ऑफ प्लेजर एंड हैप्पीनेस देर इज दुख एंड प्रतिकूलात्मक एक्सपीरियंस फॉर द योगी विदाउट एनी एक्सप्लेनेशन दैट हैज बीन सेड सो व्यास हिमसेल्फ आस्क्स कथम तद उपपद्यते हाउ डज दैट मेक सेंस नाउ टू आंसर दैट द नेक्स्ट सूत्र कम्स इन विच इज 2.15 It says...
Before going to that sutra, I will just give an example. Here, it's an enigmatic statement. If you say that even pleasure is painful, what's the logic here? What's the logicality? That the pleasure is also painful. See, and this is with reference to yogi. Then how we have to understand the logic behind it. The yogi doesn't have to look for logic. He knows very well that pleasures are also going to give pain. So let us try to understand, even at our hierarchy, at our level of consciousness. Suppose we get delight. What is going to be the outcome of it? The delight will create attachment to instruments which give pleasure, and the very pleasure, object of pleasure, experience of pleasure, and instrument of pleasure. So it will create attachment to us. We'll be developing attachment. It never happens that we are experiencing delight, we have enjoyed delight, but we have not generated any attachment. So in our case, it doesn't happen. So we will definitely generate some attachment. Now, once we develop attachment, means what? we start developing thirst. I should have repetition of the pleasure, either the same pleasure more and more often, or little high potency pleasure more than this pleasure. I should get either more than this pleasure or this pleasure at least. Now, because of attachment, we end up doing, by hook or crook, we will try to get the pain and pleasure. We will try to repeat that pleasure by hook or crook because of the attachment. Now, therefore, what will happen? We will be doing anything. By hook or crook means what? So we will be again committing vice and virtue, both. We want to somehow get the pleasure once again, so we will not be necessarily going for a judicious means to get the pleasure. If the attachment is strong, then we will go by indiscreet means and indiscreet process and try to get. So that means again we are inviting sorrow, because we will be committing even sin to get that pleasure by hook or crook. And therefore, we will be getting again the sorrow as well along with the pleasure. Although we have attachment for pleasure, because of attachment for pleasure, we will be try to get it by hook or crook. Therefore, even the vice will be committed, and therefore we will be attracting bitter fruits as well. And the attachment will go on escalating. Suppose we get more delight by whatever we do, then again we will be committing same kind of act. So we become more indiscreet, unjudicious, injudicious, blind, because delights give pleasures. So delight give pleasures, and pleasures give attachment. Therefore, even in delights, there is hidden pain. So of course, this will become clear in the next sutra. But this is a logic that we can understand. That we want to go behind dealers, delights and get more and more delights. But then there is attachment created invariably. And attachment will make us blind. We will try to get it by hook or crook. Then if you are a crook, then naturally you are going to get such fruits, corresponding fruits. So that's a logic for us to understand that we should not be pleasure seekers also. If you are seeking pleasure, then we are going to get attachment. That's why we must be neutral even when the pleasures come to us. We should be neutral when the pains come to us. Because when the pains are coming, then we will be reacting. If we react again, we become indiscreet. If we become indiscreet, we will be blind. If we are blind, we will be doing anything without intelligence. And therefore, that is going to cost us. Therefore, in yoga, we are asked to be neutral to both delights and sorrows. So when you are neutral, you won't react, or you won't strongly react, or not even react also. So if you don't react, you are not going to commit yourself to karmas, which entail fruits. So that's why even delights have sorrows, as much as sorrows have sorrows. Anyway, this will become more clear in that.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. So now all of this is described in detail as Vyasa goes about explaining it. I just wanted to draw the attention to the sort of the rigorous tone that is being taken here. Because Vyasa first says that even at times of pleasure, dukkham asti eva, there is sorrow only, pratikulatmakam, problematic, yoginaha, for the yogi. Said, okay, you are saying that, but how does it make sense? Katham tad utpadyate. Okay, so the intent is to sort of open it out, not leave anything unexplained. So now the next sutra comes in. It says, Parinama tapa samskara dukkhaihi gunavritti virodhaccha dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha. So we will see the meaning of all of these as we come into the bhashya. But essentially, parinama tapa samskara dukkhaihi, that is by three kinds of dukkhas. One is the parinama dukkha, another is the tapa dukkha, and the samskara dukkha, by these three, and by gunavritti virodhaccha. So here in the text, there is something that is called pathantaram. So some texts say gunavritti virodhaccha. So some renditions or some versions of this text is gunavritti avirodhaccha. But now the sort of the beauty is the purport still remains the same, which we will see when we again come to the commentary. So because of these three kinds of dukkha and because of the gunavritti virodha, guna here refers to sattva rajatama, and again we will see in detail why is that a factor. But because of these two sets of reasons, dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha, to the viveki means to the discerning wise person who is able to see things as they are, dukkhameva sarvam, everything is the nature of dukkha. That is what is being said in this sutra. Now just to get some confusion out of the way, this is not to say that the yogi is always sad. That is not what is being said. It is what is being said is that yogi has the wisdom to see the true nature of the lada and paritapa phala, to see that eventually or essentially they are both based or suffused with dukkham. And we'll see why and what the yogi does and how that is a gateway to jnana and sort of the leading of life with viveka. So we'll see that. Now, another sort of incidental thing, dukkha and in general, the worldly sorrow is sort of a very important, has an important place in Adhyatma. In fact, the allied darshana, the Sankhya darshana, in the Sankhya Karika, the very first line of the Karika is about that. It says, dukkha trayabhigata jignyasa. Okay, dukkha trayabhigata jignyasa. Tad abhigatake hetau drushte sapartha chet naikantatyantato bhavat. So we'll not get into the details of the Karika here, but essentially there also it says that there is this dukkhatraya. The dukkhatraya means, which we have already seen, adibhautika, adidaivika, adhyatmika dukkham. So all of these dukkhas, they are tormenting, and there is a desire to go beyond that or get rid of that. That brings in a jignyasa. Jignyasa means a wish to know, the desire to know. So it is known as sananta pratyayaha. Okay. So jnya is the root. Jignyasa means the desire to know. In order to get rid of that, what follows in that karika is the entire Sankhya Shastra. It says in order to get rid of that permanently. So here also the dukkha angle is coming in, and what is being said is this samsara dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha, and this is the part that now Vyasa will describe in detail so that we understand what is being said. So Vyasa begins by saying, sarvasya ayam raganuviddha chetana chetana sadhanadhinaha sukhanubhavaha iti satrasi ragajaha karmashayaha. So this is same as what was just explained. Sarvasya ayam raganuviddha. So all of this sukhanubhava. So all of this what? Pleasurable experiences is raganuviddha. So pervaded by this feeling of raga. Raga means desire and longing and attachment. So raganuviddha. Everything meaning chetana chetana sadhanani, whatever gives pleasure, whether it is a sentient being like friends, family and so on, or insentient things in the world, whatever are pleasurable, they are essentially pervaded with raga, or they bring about attachment or desire or wish. Iti tatra asti ragajaha karmashayaha. So what does that give rise to? Ragajaha means when you say raga jaha means born out of raga, the born out of desire, born out of attachment. So raga jaha karmashayaha. So essentially the karmashaya is growing. And what is the type of this karmashaya? It is raga jaha, attachment driven. So if we have already seen klesha moolaha karmashayaha, and all of this karmashaya is caused by kleshas. We know that raga is one of the kleshas. And here it is being said that even the happy experiences, the sukha anubhava, इज प्रॉब्लमैटिक बिकॉज इट गिव्स राइज टू राग कर्माशय तथा च सिमिलरली द्वेष्टि दुःख साधनानि मुह्यति चेति द्वेष मोह कृतोऽप्यस्ति कर्माशयः. सो ऑन द कॉन्ट्ररी साइड, ऑन द ऑपोजिट साइड, वेर एवर देर इज अ दुःख साधनम, समथिंग दैट कॉजेस पेन सॉरो टॉर्मेंट, अबाउट दैट देर इज सॉर्ट ऑफ अवर्जन. सो दैट अवर्जन कॉजेस द्वेष एंड मोह विच इज कॉजिंग अगेन एन इंक्रीज ऑफ कर्माशय विच इज अगेन क्लेश मूल. क्लेश हियर इज द्वेष एंड दैट टाइप ऑफ कर्माशय इज ग्रोइंग. सो वेदर यू हैव साधनानी, दीज आर थिंग्स और पीपल और सेंटियंट बीइंग्स, वेदर दे आर गिविंग यू हैप्पी एक्सपीरियंसेस, वेदर दे आर गिविंग सैड एक्सपीरियंसेस, एसेंशियली दैट इज लीडिंग टू एन इंक्रीज इन कर्माशय. So the point here is, it is of the nature of dukkha for everybody, not just for the yogi. However, it is the yogi or the viveki who is able to see that and understand that. The others are just floating along the tides of life and not able to see that. So they are getting happy and sad in turn, longing for happiness, going away, trying to go away from sorrow. But in all of this, they don't notice that the karmashaya is growing. तो व्यासा से तथा च उक्तम न अनुपहत्य भूतानि उपभोगः संभवतीति हिंसा कृतोऽप्यस्ति शारीरः कर्माशयः. तो व्यासा इज कोटिंग हियर, ही सेज विदाउट टेकिंग और विदाउट सीजिंग, एसेंशियली विदाउट कंज्यूमिंग थिंग्स, द उपभोग basically the consuming, the consumption, the bhoga is not possible. And this type of seizing, taking and so on is himsa krutopyasti sharira karmashaya. So this gives rise to karmashaya due to the sharira acts of taking things away or trying to collect things for oneself. So through different examples, the increase in karmashaya is being illustrated. We have seen the ragaja karmashaya, the dveshaja karmashaya, the mohaja karmashaya, and now the sharira karmashaya. Then he says, vishaya sukhancha avidyetyuktam. So now this is a sort of an essential statement. He says, vishaya sukham, the sukha, the happiness coming out of the objects of senses is nothing but avidya. So vishaya sukhancha avidyetyuktam. Again, as a reminder, avidya is the root of all kleshas, and the kleshas are the root of karmashaya. And the karmashaya is the root of complete samsara and prapancha. So you can see how things are being linked. So vishaya sukham cheva avidyetyuktam. Ya bhogeshu indriyanam truptehe upashantihi tat sukham. So ya means the upashanti means the momentary quietness or the sort of the non-essential quietness of the indriyas coming from the bhoga, from the senses are getting their pleasurable experiences, then they are satisfied. That is the trupti that gives the temporary stopping of the uneasiness of the senses. That is the upashanti, and that is sukham. Ya bhogeshu indriyanam truptehe upashantihi tat sukham. And then dukham, या लौल्यात अनुपशांति तदुखम. लौल्य मीन्स अनस्टेडीनेस और एक्सेसिव पैशन, अनइजीनेस, फिकलनेस. सो दी सेंसेस आर लॉन्गिंग फॉर समथिंग एंड दे आर अनइजी. दैट अनुपशांति विच कॉजेस सॉर्ट ऑफ द ऑपोजिट ऑफ शांति, ऑपोजिट ऑफ ईज, सो देर इज अनइजीनेस, दैट इज दुखम. सो व्यास इज क्लैरिफाइंग हियर वॉट इज दिस विषय सुखम and the opposite dukkham that is being referred to here, which the common man will refer to as sukha and dukkha. So essentially, when the senses, including the mind, they feel this kind of upashanti because the satisfaction through bhoga, they feel this is sukham. If that is not there, the uneasiness of the indriyas and the manas, that is the lauljam, is the dukkham. So here that is being clarified. And then Vyasa says, नच इंद्रियाणां भोगाभ्यासेन वैतृष्ण्यं कर्तुं शक्यम्. So again, he is anticipating that sort of the opponent or the reader might be thinking that, okay, why not give the experiences, the pleasurable experiences to the indriyas, and therefore they will be completely satisfied, and vaitrishnam means there will be no more desire. Vaitrushnam is similar to vairagyam. So there is a desire tendency will go away, and therefore the problem is solved. So Vyasa says that is not possible. Just by bhoga abhyasena. Abhyasa means punaf punakarane, doing this again and again. So if you give more, and indriyas are asking for more pleasurable experiences, you give more and more, and that will remove their desire. That line of thinking is invalid. Tat nashakyam. And next time we'll see kasmat, why. So far we have just begun on this sutra, and what we are seeing is when Vyasa said dukkhameva sarvam yoginaha or dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha, why is that being said? How does that make sense? And so far we have seen this happens because the sukhanubhava, dukkhanubhava, all of this increases the karmashaya. That is one thing that we have seen. We have also seen that bhoga sort of implies consuming things, taking things, which also causes sharira karmashaya. And then we saw here the precise statements defining the sukha and dukkha in question, which is the sukha and dukkha of the indriyas. And then putting forth clearly that if having heard all this, somebody thinks, okay, if that is what indriyas want, let me give more and more bhoga, and that will stop their desire. That line of thinking is invalid. So we'll stop here. The commentary is a long one, so and we'll continue that next time. And just we also touched upon the importance of dukkha and getting rid of that by showing how the very first line of the Sankhya Karika refers to that, and in fact it begins with that. We'll stop here with that. Okay. So we'll chant the shlokas on Guruji and continue next time. वैज्ञानिकं प्रवक्तृत्व आसनेषु कलाविदं योगाभ्यासे च तत्त्वज्ञं वन्देहं सुन्दरं गुरुं योगवृक्षो हि लोकेऽस्मिन् यत्प्रेरणेन वर्धितः योगाचार्यगुरो तुभ्यं सुन्दराय नमो नमः. थैंक यू.
नमस्कार. थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू.